Bourbon reformers established this port of San Blas, which you see is pretty close to Acapulco, and this was seen as a threat. So San Blas was a naval shipyard. It wasn't a commercial port, but it was immediately perceived by Mexico City merchants as a threat to their monopoly control of the import of Asian products. And in fact, I would argue that from Spain, they were hoping to split this whole region, which I call the Greater West, off from Mexico City's control and leave Mexico City and Acapulco with supplying for the southern region. And that would have, of course, cut the power Mexico City could control markets in half. Well, we're going to skip that one. Okay, now, so three rival groups seek to control San Blas. The first is its founder, José de Gálvez, who's the most powerful politician in Carlos III's empire. And taking orders from Gálvez, he appoints Comisario Trillo, Francisco Trillo, to run San Blas. And they want to reduce the power of the coastal of Mexico, and they also want to tax silver, which there's a lot of silver from this region. In Mexico City, the large merchants, the largest merchants, and my example is Pedro Hayes, they want to protect Acapulco's monopoly, and ideally they would like to shut San Blas down and certainly keep commerce out. And then we have regional merchants, such as Josef Antonio Perez y Crespo. I will hereafter call him Josef Perez, or just Perez. He lived in Tepic, which is just behind San Blas, and people like him were looking for an opportunity to co-opt San Blas and make it the key to their own business ventures expanding. And they really needed that. So here you see a critical factor, which is this big silver belt. I mean, this is still a major silver belt in the world. And the trade with Asia was textiles from Asia for silver from the Americas. Now, the silver was supposed to go to Mexico City and on to Spain. Okay, but a lot of it leaked out into the Gulf of California, and here you see San Blas. So, you know, how much leaked out? Well, a great challenge for studying these things is lack of data. But I think there, you know, I have seen data in other periods. There were about 4 million pesos coming out, which would be about 15% of what was produced. Okay, and notice here that the China trade route comes down from Monterrey and San Diego, and it links, here's San Blas, and it links up with this flow of silver heading down to Panama, or maybe to India. The British were on the other side of Panama in Jamaica, so that's where it either went to British India or to Jamaica. Okay, moving right along. Okay, now, so a big question is, what is bourbon reform? And in analyzing the structure of San Blas, I'm really thinking about this. What is bourbon reform? Guadalajara any funds for the working or collecting of salt until you provide me the report about that matter which I asked for on the 10th of the current month. I ordered Don Jose Trigo to stop sending you any funds that you may ask for. God grant you many years. So at this time, Trillo was not only, he had a crew of ships that were going up and down the Gulf, but in addition, he was building the frigate Santiago, which was the largest ship they would ever build. It was for going to Monterey and Alaska. And this put that whole project at risk. So, just how much funding was he going to lose if he didn't take money from the tobacco factory? Well, it turns out 77% of the funding for San Blas came from the tobacco factory in Guadalajara, which was a shock to me, because Galvez had come in saying that the port should be self-sufficient. All the new institutions, the Bourbon Reformers, they were not going to be subsidized from Spain. They were going to be self-sufficient. And income from salt was supposed to be a big part of it, but that only turns out to be 11%. A big part of it was supposed to be taxes on local silver production, which turns out to be 0%. And it's the one thing that the Bourbons did that was successful is they took over state supply of tobacco and they really extracted cash from the population with that. So how does Trillo adapt to losing 77% of his funding? Well, this map shows you all the tiny little, not the great big silver mines, which would be inland, but the tiny silver mines. And the big commercial opportunity for merchants was to use these ships from San Blas to bring groceries to these different silver mining locations. And that, in the Mexican literature, it's very clear that the people that make money from silver are not the miners or the owners of the mines. They're the merchants that finance the mines. So that was really the opportunity, the commercial opportunity. So what Trillo does is he asks a local merchant in Tepique, who's in Paris, to pay the salary for 5 months of the ships, of all the ships that ply the Gulf of California. So not the ones that are going to Monterey and Alaska, but all the ships inside the Gulf of California. So that was really fascinating, because this means that already in 1771, the San Blas naval base, or the shipyard, was at least 50% controlled by mercantile actors. And then Trillo and Perez run a company store. They don't have money to pay the workers, so he says, we will give them credit at the store that we run. So then, but how is the merchant ever going to get paid? And I'm wondering if there's silver that was produced here in Baja California and nobody knows what happened to it, and I wonder if that was used to pay. But the other thing is that Trillo gives a major favor to Paris. And these are all the different mercantile actors who work together with different players in this region. So, you know, this may not be the most exciting thing for you, but it is exciting for into this, and Miguel Marin del Valle worked with the previous comisario, and he will wind up being the person that supplies the California missions. So it's, we don't have in our story of California's heritage any Hispanic mercantile actors, so this is a way of fleshing out, well, who were they, because it's not really conceivable that in imperialism you didn't have commercial actors. So Trillo gives Perez permission to sail to Acapulco and get Asian goods. Basically, the military is sailing to Acapulco anyway to get cannon made in Manila. Cannon were too heavy to bring overland. So actually, San Diego also has cannon made in Manila. So he gives the merchant permission to take 8,000 pesos down there and purchase enough stuff to bring back for their company store. Now, I think they were hoping, so Trillo didn't really have the right to give permission. And I think they were hoping they could do it quickly before the letter saying he granted the permission got to Mexico City. That didn't work out. And he gets into it, but I also think they were trying to stimulate a political policy debate, and maybe Trillo was falling on his sword to make himself the sacrificial lamb might have been a relative of Galvez, but his sadly common name is making this difficult for me to sort out. But anyway, what I did see is that the three conceptions of what bourbon reform is are not mutually exclusive, right? They're very compatible. And, you know, and this takes me one step closer. And it was also a challenge